guess what? I'm 60 years old. That's what I'm talking about. You know, all of a sudden it's about old people having sex like we don't have it. How you think you got here? What, did we wish upon a star and boom, here you are? You see, I'm 60 and I'm gonna be 61 in December and I'm proud of my age. I am, I'm proud. And I get it all the time from my friends. They're like, Caroline, you know Hollywood. You shouldn't say how old you are. They think you're too old. I don't care about Hollywood. I hope California falls off the face of the map. I live in Texas. We're not stupid. We drill for our oil here. We don't worry about protecting a bird. We don't do things like that. They protect the spotted owl because it might go extinct. We need to save it. Yeah, that's nice. I'm from Louisiana. We marinate it. I need oil and air. I'm 60. Hot flash. The bird dies.
Oil and gas. I was there almost 25 years. I got out when I was 40. And started doing stand-up.
And that's a big change.
Oh, it's a massive change, especially in the checkbook. But my world changed. Everything changed. The office environment changed. The guys that I worked for left. They retired. And the new people coming in, it just wasn't a fit for me. So I decided to start doing this. And it was a major decision. It was like, let's see what I can do. I went out to my first open mic and went home. Said, I can't do this. And it took me another 3 months before I went back to an open mic, found out what I needed to do, got on stage, bombed terribly, I mean bad, because I had stage fright so bad. And but there was something there. Something that said, I need to keep doing this. And that was 22 years ago. But it's taken me those many years to get a bank account again.
It takes balls, I'll say that. That on purpose and go, I'm gonna sit in the front row of the comedy show, nobody will know. One more time for Mr. Peter Barrera. The host, anyway. Welcome to the UN show. Got an Asian, a Mexican, and a Cajun, yeah. Yeah. Last night I came out here and did a show and had people going, you Cajun? Yeah. One more motherfucker talk to me about swamp people, I'm gonna punch him in the throat. I don't know these people. Hey man, you know Troy Landry? No, fuckhead, I don't. And I don't hunt alligators, so shut the fuck up. It's a reality show. It's bullshit. There's a camera, jackass. I do like Duck Dynasty, I'll have to admit on that one. Fucking boys look like ZZ Top, I love it. Got a little guy who made $1 million on duck calls, that's a motherfucker right there. I'm a multi-millionaire, quack. It's great to be back in Dallas, I'm glad y'all got rid of all that tornadic activity. South Louisiana, I live in Galveston, Texas, I live in the Gulf Coast, I know what it's like to experience a storm, okay? I prefer, somebody say, y'all got hurricanes, I can see that sumbitch coming for 5 fucking days. I got time to name it, play with it, whatever the fuck I want with it. I can make believe it's gonna go in another direction, I can see that bitch, okay? But a tornado, that is bullshit. It's too fast. Sally. I'll get the next one.
when I started out going on the road, which was 1995, as a feature act, I had 28, 30 weeks of work. Granted, I wasn't making a lot of money, but I was making, and this was before merchandise. This was before DVDs and CDs. Nobody was selling anything. Today, what we had back then is virtually gone. And I blame it on not only club management and one-nighter management, but I blame it on comics. I blame it on young comics who, back in those days, started, you know, they all wanted to be a star. Nobody wanted to be a real comic. That's why I went into stand-up to be a comic. I wanted to be a stand-up comedian. I wanted to make people laugh. I never looked for the sitcom. That was never my gig. Going to L.A. and having them make a movie about a weekly show about my life, that's not what I was looking for. The thought of doing that meant I had to go back to work again. I was doing a lot of work on the road, traveling. You know, at some points I was gone 8, 9, 10 weeks at a time, living from hotel to hotel to, you know, whatever. Luckily for me, I never slept in my car. I always found a cheap hotel, scary, but cheap. And, but for me, the gig was not Hollywood. It wasn't there. I wasn't moving to LA, because if I would have moved to LA, I would have had to get a day job. And I just left a day job. So, and my family's here. My family's in Louisiana. My friends were here. So I was blessed to where I got involved with, Danny Martinez, the Comedy Showcase.
And I was all excited because I'm the only woman on the show, and they said they were gonna raffle off Jose, and they said they were gonna raffle off a woman. I'm like, oh, cool, man. Wait, really? Why? Oh, man. I dyed the silver beaver. I got it already. Oh yeah, because when we go great, we go great everywhere. And that's hard to do because L'Oreal ain't made a batch to match my snatch yet. So I had to look. And that's embarrassing at Walgreens. Look, I need something to go with this. Maybe a medium ash brown that goes everywhere. Like here. But it's true, the younger generation today, for some reason, when they look at people in our age group, they go, oh, you old. You want to push that? These boots aren't just made for walking, jackass.
Once I got involved with Danny and started becoming a regular there, and he evidently saw something in me. God bless that man. And from there, I just started developing my show and my act, finding my voice, who I wanted to be on stage. And... But it was a long haul. I mean, I hear all the time, and I still hear it. You know, I can do what you do. Yes, you probably can, but you're not going to give up what I gave up to do what I do. I have no spouse. There's no husband in the house taking care of my house. I have no pets. I have no children. I come home, everybody's like, well, aren't you lonely? No, I'm never lonely. But that's who I am. That's me. I don't need to be around a lot of people. And one thing about being a stand-up or a road comic, and it takes that kind of a person, you have to like yourself a lot. Because 23 hours a day, you're by yourself. You're not around people. And it's either driving and riding, or, you know, being in a hotel room and trying to figure out the cheapest way to eat. Luckily for me, I cook, and I figured out early, bring a hot plate. And I started cooking on the road. I mean, I would learn to go and buy things. I carried a full bag of pots and pans and a hot plate and plates for me to eat on, and seasonings and spice. A friend of mine called it my magic bag. What was in your magic bag? I could pull out and cook anywhere in any hotel room. But it's not what these young comics think it is. I mean, when I hear a lot of them today say, what do I have to do? Well, you have to give up a lot. You have to give up everything. Your mistress, your husband, your kids. It's comedy. It's the road. It's the life. It's not an easy life, but it's my life, and I love it. I mean, we're sitting here tonight. I'm in the Holiday Inn Express. I leave tomorrow morning. I have to be up at 3 o'clock. Catch a 6 o'clock flight. I'm going to Belize. I'll be on a ship for 10 days. I turn around and come back. I'm home for 4 days. I turn around and get back on another ship. And then another ship. You know, and that's what I love doing. I live out of a suitcase. And that's my world. But if you want to do this as a stand-up, then this is how you're going to have to do it. But this overnight sensation, everybody I hear that, well, is it overnight? No, there's no overnight. Longest night I ever spent. You know, and I see these young cats coming out, you know, 2 years, they want a headline. No, you haven't earned it. And that's the problem, I think, today with the younger people, is that there's no work ethic. And, of course, you know, they say, well, y'all were young once, you know, that generation talked about you. No, we had a work ethic. I've been working since I'm 16.
My nephew just graduated from high school. I gave him $100 for his graduation present because I love him. He's my only nephew. And it was either $100 for his graduation or paid a Sprint bill. Trust me, I had to think about it. All right, I love him. Gave him $100. I called him up the next day. I'm like, dude, what did y'all do for graduation? Oh, it was so cool, man. It was so cool. We went to graduation. We had the ceremony. Then after that, I went to dinner with mom and dad and grandma, which is my mom. And then after that, we went back to school. They put us on lockdown till 6 in the morning, and we played games. I almost won an iPod. That's sad. You know I'm talking to you on the cricket, right? That's what you did? Yeah, what did y'all do? Really? Okay, let me tell you what we did, all right? All right, we graduated from high school. Then we went to the dance, because back in those days, we had a graduation dance, and we had dates and shit. And we all got dressed up, okay? We danced all night long. We got stoned. Some of us got pregnant that year. Not me, but I skipped that damn part of the story. Okay? All right, that's what we did. We got drunk. We got stoned. We puked. We got drunk. We got stoned. We puked. We danced some more. Then at 5 o'clock in the morning, we went back to our mom and daddy's house, and we changed clothes. We put on tank tops, flip-flops, and shorts, put 36 cases of beer in the back of a fucking pickup truck, and went to the beach for 5 damn days. That's what we did. Want me to do? I gave you $100. I expected you to get drunk and get laid. That's what the fuck I expected you to do. Then he had the nerve to say he turns 19 the day before my birthday. He goes, what are you giving me for my birthday? I'm like, a fucking advice. And a 12-pack of beer, bitch. We're gonna get your ass drunk. And he's amazing. He don't do shit. Nothing around the house. What? I'm gonna be 61. My sister turns 53 on Monday. My brother's 56.
Okay, and we are back again with Caroline Picard, the Cajun Queen. One of the things that I've noticed over the years is the fact that a lot of things have changed, and the pay scale for comics, instead of going up, has gone down. Mainly because of the fact that we have a lot of comics that are so desperate to get a road gig that they undercut other comics.
Oh God, that's rampant. That's rampant. You know, a good friend of mine, Ward Anderson, who's out of Toronto, who's originally lived here, just put out an article about 5 things you ought to know about comedians, and it has to do with the money. Is that we, you know, you see guys like Ron White and Foxworthy and Bill Burr and Louis C.K. and understand they earned the right to have the money they have. They earned it. You know, Foxworthy, like I said, the blue collar guys, even Larry, and so many people make, you know, oh, Larry the cable guy. Look, he earned that. He went out and nobody just gave it to him. He earned it. He went out on the road. He did what he had to do to get there. But beyond that, behind the scenes, there's so much going on as far as comics cutting each other's throats, backbiting, jealousy. I've lost more friends in this business. And I'll say it out loud. I lost a very good friend. I won't say his name, but I lost a very good friend. Someone I mentored, someone who I took under my wing. And he cut my throat. He thought it was a joke, but he cut my throat. And he thought I would walk in with a glass of Crown and we'd all kiss and make up. No, I come from a different world. I put my trust in you and I helped you. And you chose to go in another direction. Now the friendship is completely over. I will never not say anything about his act or his talent. He's a massive talent. He's a great talent. But the friendship's over. And you see that a lot in this business.
Because I've been in Oklahoma, and that's another thing too. People are like the weatherman. You need to tell people what county we fucking in. I've got to the point now, I'll get to a show in Oklahoma like I do with counties. This. Why? Just check it. Caroline needs to know this information. Because I did a show in Elk City, Oklahoma one time, and it was one of those night shows because the club was in the hotel, and that meant after the show, well, there's a whole lot of drinking going on. And the club owner was from South Louisiana, which meant the Crown Raw came out. And we drank a lot of Crown. I could have made a quilt out of them fucking bags. Cajuns and Crown together, and shit's gonna happen. We were cooking in the kitchen, we're doing all kinds of shit. Well, probably 2-3 o'clock in the morning, I'm like, man, dude, I gotta get to bed, I got another gig, I gotta drive to tomorrow. I get in there, and I'm taking my boots off, right? You do, you know, anybody wears boots, so you do the fucking boot dance, it's like, ugh. Especially if you're drunk, it's like, ugh. Oh, I'll sleep in them. You know. You know, I'm finally sitting in the bed taking the boots. The TV is losing its fucking mind. I'm like, what the fuck's going on? And here comes the weatherman. Tornadoes have been spotted in this county, in this county. And I'm like, oh, damn. I am drunk at my ass, screaming at the fucking TV set. What fucking county? Am I in? And then he says, if you don't have a basement, grab a mattress. For what? The flight?
They're not business people. They're not business oriented. Very few of them are. That's why they have managers and agents, and that's why some of them lose their money. That's why some of them go broke. You know, you made $6 million. Well, the IRS, well, you know, yeah, the IRS is going to come look at you, dude. Okay? And some of them are very good business managers. I know quite a few here in Houston that know how to run their business. But it's a, you know, everybody sees, oh my God, you're on stage for an hour. That's all you work. No. No. I don't have minions behind me doing my checkbook, paying my bills. It's all on us. It's all on me. Like I said, there's no husband in the house. When Caroline goes home, Caroline pays her bills. Caroline's got to take care. I got to, you know, my apartment complex loves me because my rent's always on time and I paid it from Japan. And that's, I think, with people, when they look at comedians, oh, you're, you know, and you're fun. You're fun off stage too. No, not really. Sometimes I don't even tell people what I do for a living. Because I'm tired of, well, tell me a joke. No, dude, I'm not going to. And when you say that, then they get mad at you. Well, you're an asshole. No, I'm off work. What do you do for a living? I'm an accountant. Well, you know what? Do my taxes for free. And that's what people don't understand. Yes, we're comics. Yes, we make people laugh. And I love it. I can't wait to get on the ship tomorrow and get on stage and do what I do. But at a certain point, and it's like I tell people, When I take my boots off, because I'm known for my red boots, when the boots come off, the Cajun Queen is off and Caroline is now on. And Caroline's not always funny. Doesn't happen.
I remember last year reading an article where a man was sitting there and saying, oh, well, women are just trying to be men on stage.
No, I'm trying to be who I am. Let me tell you something. I did a DVD. And you taped it. It's called I'm Not That Woman. And that DVD was specifically done to explain. Not, I'm the type of woman that never had the dream of Prince Charming. Never. Never. I read the Cinderella stories. I read all the stories just like every little girl. That wasn't who I was. I wasn't even like that when I was young. When I was, you know, I grew up in a world, in a very small town, in a neighborhood full of boys. And I grew up as a tomboy. I was the firstborn, and that's my world. I never had that dream. And that's another thing, too. And I tell the people in my shows today, when I do that bit about I'm not that woman, is that why in the name of everything that's holy that you have to feel that a woman has to be what you think. Okay? Well, you have to get married. You have to get, what's wrong with you? I get that question. I've had that question since the day I hit this, since the day my brain worked and I could answer a question. And when I hit 19 and 20, and where my friends were getting married and having kids, I was thinking of going to other places. And when I hit 24 and I moved to Houston, and this was 77, the party was on in Houston in 1977. It was the age of disco. It was the age of more freedom than anything else.
My mom passed away a couple of months ago, and I love Miss Bernice, man. She was like a second mother to me. Because I ran around with her daughters, and we were the badasses. We were the kids, the chicks that got in trouble, man. We were the ones that started smoking pot early. We were the ones who did all the dirt, the shit. We got in trouble. And I'm looking at these women that I used to run with, and I'm going, what the fuck happened to y'all? Y'all are old. And they talking about bullshit, like, you know, medication I've never heard of. You know, there are triglycerides and cholesterol and high blood pressure, and I'm like, One of my friends said, she said, Caroline, you eat gluten? I'm like, bitch, I don't know. I had some boudin this morning. I don't know. Fuck, I sucked a dick last night. I'm sure there was some gluten in that shit. It wasn't written on the side, but I don't know. If he ate gluten, I ate gluten. That's the way that shit went. With no gluten in it. It's a fucking cat, for God's sake. Cats where I live grew up eating mice. I don't know if there's gluten in a fucking mouse, but I'm trying to. And she's like, what, don't you take medication? I'm like, yeah, Coors Light. Crown Royal. Merlot. She's like, well, that's great because, you know, the doctor said one glass of wine a night. I'm like, one glass? Bitch, that's like one chip. That shit ain't gonna happen. Saddest part of my night is when that wine bottle hits the trash can. Fuck. Yeah, I'll go to Walmart and get tomorrow. And they're looking at me, they're like, you don't look like us. You look different. What's that look? I'm like, happiness? They're like, well, what makes you so happy? I'm like, well, for one thing, I never got married. Yeah. And one of my friends, I grew up with her from first grade. She looks at me and goes, oh. I'm like, all right, Janice, you want to explain oh to me? She's like, oh, well, you don't have a husband. We always knew you were different. Oh, I'm like, oh, you think I'm gay. Well, you don't have a husband. I'm like, well, sweetie, I got two of them, and their wives don't let them out as often as I'd like. Okay, which I called my mom up and said, you're going to hear some shit. Don't believe it, all right? I was just jacking around. She said, well, you don't have...
But I'm starting to talk to some of the younger ones. Okay? And I'm starting to tell them what to do. And some of them are listening. But this is a job. This is, you need experience. You can't talk on stage at the age of, and you know, especially with some of the male comics. How many more masturbation jokes can we hear? Smoking weed. How much more of that can we hear?
Oh, no. The rape jokes.
Oh, rape. Oh, yeah. Y'all think that's funny? Tell you what. You know how much funny I think that is? Put your ass in prison. Somebody put a dick up your ass and see how funny that is without your permission. Then come talk to me. There's nothing funny about rape. I don't care if it comes out of a woman's mouth. There's nothing funny about it. There's nothing funny about domestic violence. There's nothing funny about racism. There's nothing funny about that. You know, for me, and this is my opinion, all of this is my opinion. Whether you agree with it or not, I could give a rat's ass. But this is my opinion. When I get on that stage, I give a message. I want people to be more optimistic. I want people to understand something. The only way this is going to work is if you stand your ground and stop acting like idiots. Racism in this country should have died years ago, but the media keeps shoving it down our throat. And shame on you politicians, and shame on you media for doing that. It's all about selling toothpaste. We got that. Okay? And the fact is, this is what I do on that. Yes, I'm conservative. Yes, It's like people say, how do you vote? What color are my boots? But I'm not across the board party. I vote for the best person. I vote for who I think is going to do the best. And I feel as a comedian, it's my job to get out there and tell people, hey, look, yeah, this is crap. And it's funny. I make it funny. But you can make the change. It's up to you.
Because we had to do chores, man. It didn't fucking matter if you were the boy in the family or the girl in the family. You wanted to use daddy's car side of the night, you fucking mowed the yard. And back in those days, we didn't have a damn riding lawnmower. How many of y'all remember this fun game? Fuck. Fuck. And your daddy's in the back with a beer in his hand hollering at you, choke it! What? Choke it! I'll choke you, you son of a bitch. My uncle's damn lawnmower, and my uncle was a Fred Sanford of fucking Coonass Land, okay? That bastard didn't buy nothing new. He would go everywhere and get parts and pieces and put this Frankenstein fucking lawnmower together. It had two big wheels on the back, one little small wheel on the front, and you mow in the fucking yard like this. And I'm like, Daddy, well, he said, go get a spark plug from your uncle. Did my uncle buy spark plugs? Fuck no. Oh, hell no. He raised the hood of his car, put out a spark plug, washed it off in gasoline, gave it to me and said, bring that back here. This shit don't grow on trees. You put the spark plug in and you mowed the fucking yard. No question. One of my friends looked at me. She said, I don't understand that story. Where was the instructions in all this? I'm like, you didn't hear my daddy yell, choke it? And my uncle said, bring back the spark plug. That was the fucking instructions right there. She said, well, weren't you afraid to mow your foot? I'm like, you know, I don't know what it was back then. I could have been in the water. But we had something called common sense. And when we saw what the blade did to the grass, we kind of figured it would fuck up my foot.
That's what's going to happen. But the fact that they're bringing Cosby back tells me they may be going and finally going, oh, really? The baby boomers want something different to watch than this bullshit that they got? You know? And, oh, baby boomers have money.
Yeah.
Maybe we need to make them happy.
Exactly.
So, we'll see. I can't predict the future, but I can predict there's going to be a fuck up somewhere.
Of course. And again, thank you.
You're very welcome.